The third question is always about Islamic fiqh. And so the fiqh question I chose, I combined many questions in one. Vanilla extract, alcohol in food, and kombucha tea. Who knows what kombucha tea is? Who has tasted kombucha tea? Who has tasted kombucha tea? Not a single person. Come on. Okay, is it tasting good or not? Saraha, he doesn't like how it tastes. Okay, now is it halal or haram? That's my question. Okay.
وما أرسلنا من قبلك إلا رجالا نوحي إليهم فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون.
I asked you how it tasted, and I'm going to ask you. So I'm combining a lot of questions into one. And in this question is basically about having minute quantities of alcohol in one's food. Now, realize this is a very complex topic. I'm going to try to summarize it, inshallah, in 5 minutes. The basic rule, our Prophet ﷺ said, hadith is in Sunan al-Nisa'i, مَا أَسْكَرَ كَثِيرُهُ فَقَلِيلُهُ حَرَامٌ. This is the basic maxim or principle that is coming from the tongue of our Prophet ﷺ. Memorize it. It is a hadith and it is a rule of fiqh. That which intoxicates in large quantities is haram in small quantities. This is a maxim of fiqh and it is a hadith. That which intoxicates in large quantities is haram in small quantities. So, whatever intoxicates in large quantities, by large quantities, we don't mean if you drink a lake. You will die if you drink a lake. We mean that which a reasonable average person may consume in a short period of time. 5, 6, 7, 8 glasses, okay? Anything beyond this, you're talking about dying before you. If something kills you before it intoxicates you, that's not haram, okay? Water will kill you if you drink, you know, gallons and gallons in a very short period, as has happened recently in a number of times. So if something intoxicates in a reasonably large quantity, a very minute light beer, for example, if you drink 10 glasses, you'll become intoxicated. Therefore, a drop of that beer is haram. Because if 10 glasses intoxicates, 10 small glasses, a person can drink 10 glasses in an hour or two. If that will intoxicate, then a drop of that beer, if you put it on your tongue, it is haram. مَا أَسْكَرَ كَثِيرُهُ فَقَلِيلُهُ حَرَامٌ. However, a number of points. First and foremost, khamr is not alcohol. Not every alcohol is khamr, not every khamr is alcohol. The Islamic prohibition is on khamr, not on alcohol. Alcohol is a class of chemical compounds. Anything that has an OH radical becomes an alcohol. Not every alcohol is khamr. Methanol is not khamr. It will kill you before it intoxicates you. Methanol is not khamr. The primary alcohol in our times that is khamr is ethanol or ethyl alcohol. That is what is found in beer and in other products. And there are other types of alcohol that also intoxicate. But not every alcohol intoxicates, and not every intoxicant is an alcohol. Therefore, when you pick up a food item and you read all the ingredients and you read something, isopropyl, glycol, whatever, alcohol, don't just say, oh, haram. You need to do your research. Majority of those alcohols are chemical alcohols, not khamr. What is clearly intoxicating or potentially intoxicating is ethanol or ethyl alcohol, both the same thing. So, not all ethyl alcohol is haram as well. Why? Because if the quantity of ethanol is so minuscule that it will not intoxicate you, then it is not khamr, even if there's ethanol in there. And the classic example for this is vanilla. See, we need to look at what is the purpose of that ethanol as well. Vanilla is a chemical compound that is found in a particular substance, the vanilla fruit or nut. It is extracted, that is a taste. And in order to get that extraction from that extraction to your cake, to your ice cream, there must be a mechanism to preserve the vanilla. And that mechanism is ethanol. Ethanol, as every chemist and every person who studies chemistry knows, ethanol is innate and it does not interact with the substance. That's why it's so useful. You can put another substance in ethanol and preserve the substance from the production to your kitchen. So ethanol therefore becomes a solvent that has no actual role other than to preserve. How can you extract this and then take it to the kitchen? It is via the mechanism of the ethanol. So vanilla extract has a lot of ethanol, but the purpose of the ethanol is what? It is to preserve the flavor of the vanilla. And then how much do you add? You will add half a teaspoon. You will add a few drops, and that will then be to your whole cake or to your homemade ice cream, which you will invite me to taste this, inshallah, if it's ice cream. So that amount of vanilla extract that you add, it will never be enough to intoxicate you. It will never. You can eat lots of vanilla ice cream. Somebody has experience doing that. I won't point any fingers. You can eat lots of vanilla ice cream and you will not feel any intoxication. مَا أَسْكَرَ كَثِيرُ فَقَلِيلُ حَرَامٍ. That which intoxicates in large is haram in small. Therefore, that which does not intoxicate in large is halal in large and small. You can eat vanilla ice cream, you can eat vanilla cake, you will not become intoxicated. Therefore, it is halal, because it does not intoxicate in large quantities. As well, some natural fermentation might occur. Actually, at the molecular level, orange juice, apple juice might have some fermentation. If you were to do a very detailed chemical study of your orange juice at home, you might find some fermentation, some ethanol produced. Does it make orange juice haram? No, because you can drink a lot of orange juice, and what will happen? You might get sick, but you won't become intoxicated. So small, minuscule quantities are overlooked. Now, what if somebody says, then therefore, why can't we go to a steakhouse, halal steakhouse? We'll get to the meat issue in a few weeks. I've already been bombarded with meat. That's on the agenda as well. Meat is always on the agenda. Don't worry. Alhamdulillah. So you go to a halal steakhouse, and they add wine. And you will say, Sheikh, you just said that if it doesn't intoxicate in large quantities, halal in small quantities. I can eat 2, 3, 4 of these steaks. I don't know what type of stomach you have, but okay. And I will not become intoxicated. Does that make the steak halal? We say there's another principle. And this is one of the principles of the Sharia. Al-umuru bimaqasidiha. Actions are judged by their intentions. This is actually the first principle in a science called the qawaid, or the maxims of fiqh. There's a branch of Islamic studies called the maxims of Islamic law. The number one maxim, the first maxim, is you judge actions by the intention. So we do not say the ruling of vanilla extract is the same as the ruling of meat in which vodka or rum has been added. Why? Because what is the purpose of the ethanol in the vanilla extract? It is to preserve the flavor of the vanilla and to make the ethanol irrelevant. What is the purpose of adding wine into the meat? To get the taste of the wine. Al-umuru bimaqasidiha. We do not say the same ruling applies. And so we say the one is halal, vanilla, and the other is haram, because the goal there is to taste the vodka or the rum or the wine, whereas the goal here, actually, ethanol is inert. You don't even taste the ethanol. The point is to taste the what? The vanilla. So to conclude this, we say, number one, first thing, is it khamr? And khamr is that which intoxicates the mind. If it's not khamr, it's halal. So we look at the ingredients. Not every alcohol is khamr. Not every khamr is alcohol. There are certain khamrs that are not alcoholic, right? Number two, does consuming it in a reasonable quantity intoxicate? If it does, then it is haram. So if you eat whatever, you know, marijuana cake, you know, you have these marijuana, you know, cookies, right? You have the cookies, huh? Oh, sorry, brownies. Somebody, people know better than I do. I don't know this as well as some of our brothers do. Okay, so the Khabir knows, mashallah, his products better. So our brother knows his brownies and not chocolate chip cookies. My mind went to cookies, but he says, no, it is sold only as brownies. But how do you know? Maybe somebody sells it as cookies. But anyway, so brownies. If you have these brownies, that will make you high. And if you have to eat 6 or 7 brownies to get high, can you eat a piece of brownie? Yes or no? No. Based on what? مَا أَسْكَرَ كَثِيرُ فَقَلِيلُ حَرَامٍ. Clear? Okay. Now, vanilla cake. You can eat and eat and eat. Will you get high? No. Then you can eat cake. Okay? That's the second principle. The third principle, even if it doesn't intoxicate you, you then go to the rule number three. Why was it added? Maqasid. What was the goal of adding? If it was added to be a secondary product, to preserve the flavor of the vanilla, we say it's overlooked, because attabi'u tabi'u, there's another principle. That which is, anyway, I mean, this is basically, you look at the, but if it was added for the taste, we say no, that was the intention, so we then say it is not allowed. Is that clear? Therefore, vanilla, is it halal or haram? Yes or no? Halal. Kombucha tea, what did I say about it? Huh? I didn't say anything. Very good. Why didn't I say anything? Because some varieties of kombucha tea, especially the homemade brews, are actually intoxicating. However, the kombucha teas that are sold in the market by law, because they are because they are sold as non-alcoholic products, by law, they are not allowed to be intoxicating. Therefore, we can say that those teas, and what is kombucha tea? It is essentially, for the Ahnaf here, it is like the nabith. It is similar to nabith, where you allow something to be fermented only for a little bit and then you stop it, right? And nabith is a classical drink that the Hanafis allowed and the others did not allow. And the kombucha tea is something similar. It's a natural fermentation that is stopped. It's not allowed to go all the way. Just a little bit is done. And its main purpose is probiotics, they say. They say. I have not tasted it. You guys are, mashallah, more experienced in cookies and vanillas and whatnot. No, vanilla, sorry. I am experienced in vanilla. No problem. I am the khabir in vanilla. I am the sheikh of ice cream. No problem, yes. But other things, I'll leave it to you guys. No problem. So, kombucha, inshallah, it is halal if it is sold in the marketplace. As for the one who makes it at home, I cannot give a verdict because sometimes those who brew it at home, they allow it to ferment more than it should be. As for the one that is sold in the market, inshallah, it is halal. Nonetheless, the level of ethanol needs to be just monitored, even though according to our government's laws, it is not allowed to sell kombucha tea unless the amount of ethanol is insignificant, in which case it would be halal to do. Allah knows best.
لا يزال الخير حيا لا يزال إن في الدنيا سلاما وظلال أخبر الأيام أنها في وصال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال